So the next standard that we have to discuss is Ind AS 16 or IFRS 16 leases. It is recommended that a student should watch this lecture only after he has completed financial instruments Ind AS 32 109 or IAS 32 IFRS 9. Okay. Why? Because the concept of discounting explained over here, how the asset should be accounted or valued, is something that is related to the standard of financial instruments. Okay, so it is recommended here, you should first watch the video over there and then come to watch this video. Now, what do we mean by leases? Lease is a contract, or it may be a part of the contract. It's not the complete contract, but it is just a part of the overall contract that you have entered into that conveys a right to use an asset. Right to use an asset. It does not talk about service. It only talks about asset for a period of time, for a period of time in exchange for consideration. So one thing, there should be a contract. Two, there should be a right to use an asset. Three, it should be for a period. Four, it should be for a consideration. So let's say your friend gives you his car to use for a period of, let's say, next 3 years, but he does not ask for any money. This is not lease because the first condition of consideration is not standing over there. Okay. Now you provide a CA service to a firm at a monthly rent of 10,000 rupees. Let's say you are giving some internal audit. So there is a contract. There is a period defined, there is consideration, but this is service, this is not an asset, so this is not a lease. Okay, now you take a machine and the rent that you are paying is 10,000 per month. The period for which you are going to use the machine is not defined. It could be any period. We don't consider such contracts to be leases. I hope you are getting the points that I am trying to explain. Or it could be that you just take up some machine from somewhere and start using it belonging to some of your relatives. But there is no contract. This is not considered to be a lease. I hope all the concepts that I told you are clear over here. So now there are lots of things that we need to see. First thing, a very basic example. I take a car on lease for a period of, let's say, 2 years. In these 2 years, I am going to pay rent for the car. So there's a contract, there's a time period, there is consideration, and there is an asset. So I will call this as a lease. But let's say you are booking this Uber or Ola car for a period of, let's say, 2 years, contracted to start from destination A and end at destination B. Okay, start at destination A, end at destination B. And this is for 2 years for exchange of consideration or whatsoever be the case. Now, this is not an asset, this is a service. You are not just taking a car, you are taking cab driver's service who will come pick you up and then drop you. Okay, now this is service. But let's say this destination thing is not defined. We are not defining where to start, where to stop. We take a book a car for a particular period and we can decide where we want the car to go, where to stop, where the person has to halt, all other things, like maybe going for a Zoom car. So this is lease. So I need to be very clear about when we are talking about lease and when we are talking about service. There is a difference between an asset and a service. Always the two will work differently. Okay. Now, if we consider these 4 points together in anything, the first thing that should always be there is an asset. Or there could be an underlying asset, like taking a car on lease along with a driver. The driver is the only person who will run the car. But we can take it wherever we want. So we have a control over the asset, right? So obviously this can also be a lease, but there is service element also. So we need to bifurcate the service element and the contract. So it is like a contract and it is a part of the contract. There can be a split. Lots of things, lots of concept comes under this definition. In fact, now this definition is so wide that if any person gives you a contract to work on job work basis, okay, you have to run your factory on job work basis. Let's say Parle Ji comes to you and says that you have to make Parle Ji biscuit. Raw material will be provided by them and you have to manufacture the biscuits for them. Now the first question is the factory on lease or we are providing them with the service to that extent you will have to think when we talk about leases. Okay, I hope the concept that I am trying to explain to you is understood over here. What is a contract? Agreement between two or more parties that is enforceable. So if something is not enforceable, it is not considered to be a contract. So for a contract, it should be challengeable in the court of law. Okay, then we'll consider it to be contract. Right to use the asset is an asset that represents lessee's right, the person who is taking the asset on lease. The person who is taking the asset on lease to use the underlying asset for a lease term. That is, he can use the asset as per his requirement. He has control over the asset for a specified period. Definitely, the control is a restricted control. Like taking a car on lease, people will say you should not go outside the state or outside a particular territory. You should not use the car in a particular area or maybe a particular timing. So these are just simple restriction. Does not mean that you don't have control over the asset. Okay. Now let's say you have a vehicle. You buy a vehicle. Now the vehicle, government has defined the speed that you should not exceed 80 or 100 at the case, maybe on highway and even on roads, 40, 60, various speeds are defined. Okay. Now, this doesn't mean that I don't have control over the asset. I have control over the asset. Did you get my point? So there are certain restrictions that lessor may impose, but doesn't mean that lessee does not have the right to use the underlying asset. Period is the time that the asset is to be used to fulfill a particular contract. Underlying asset is the asset that is subject to lease, for which the right to use the asset has been provided by a lessor to the lessee. Okay. Asset that is subject of lease, right to use that asset, like what has been leased. Now this should be defined. It should not be an undefined asset. Now what do I mean by defined or undefined asset? Let's say we book a particular car. I am sticking to the example of car so that we can see various options that are available. You take a car on lease, the person sends you a car. Car has a number MH01B2968. Let's say, just a random number I have written over here, MH01B2968. Now this vehicle has been given to you on lease. This is, let's say, a Verna, Hyundai Verna. Okay. Now, if you are getting this car on lease, next day is not going to send you some other car. There is a specific underlying asset with this particular registration number which is on lease. You are not ready to accept any other car in exchange of this car. Then in that case, it is not a specific asset. It will be considered to be a service that the person is supposed to provide you car. It can be any car. So if it is not specific car, then it is not considered to be lease. It is considered to be service. Okay. Now, there could be a reason that underlying asset that was given has gone, like, is not working properly, or there are some issues with the vehicle. Then what can be the case? What can be the scenario? It says that in such a scenario, what you should do is you should, obviously he'll replace the asset. Doesn't mean that this is not lease. You should not call it that this is not lease. This is lease. Okay. Only in case the vehicle does not work properly or the product is not working properly, machine is not working properly, we will replace it. So still the contract is of underlying asset. Okay. Now who are the parties involved? There's a lessor, there's a lessee. Lessor is the person who provides the right to the asset on lease term to the other person. And lessee is the person who obtains the right, who now has the right to use the underlying of asset for a specified period. Okay. I hope it is clear till this point. There are various other definitions which we'll go through when the new terms turn up. Scope. This standard is not applicable when we talk about exploration of mineral oil, natural gas resources and similar non-regenerative resources. We have seen earlier this Ind AS 2 was not applicable, Ind AS 16 was not applicable, Ind AS 38 intangible assets was not applicable. There were lots of standards that are not applicable. But when we talk about exploration, we have a specific standard also that is available, IFRS 6 or Ind AS 106, which can also be used. Okay. Biological assets. If we talk about biological assets, only related to agriculture are not covered in this standard, because we have a specific standard, Ind AS 41, where even if the asset, biological asset, is taken on lease, is covered. But if the biological asset is taken on lease is not an agricultural asset, it is covered in this standard. Okay, let me explain it to you. There is a biological asset which is used for agri purpose. Okay, this is not covered over here. We have Ind AS 41. There is biological asset which is used for non-agri purpose. So it is covered over here if it is taken on lease, Ind AS 116. We have a biological asset which is for agri purpose, and this is a non-lease agreement. So as it is, the word is, it is not a lease agreement and it is for agri purpose, Ind AS 41. And we have a biological asset which is for non-agri purpose and it is on non-lease. Okay, did you get my point? So if we talk about this non-lease thing, this is either covered in Ind AS 16 or it is covered in Ind AS 2 inventory. I hope it is clear. You may write all these points down, okay, to have an understanding of scope. What is scoped out? This is what is scoped out. Let's move it. Service concession arrangements, IFRIC 12 of service concession arrangement, or maybe we talk about appendix to Ind AS 115 revenue recognition. Okay, service concession arrangements where you have like constructed a road maybe, and now you are going to go for toll collection. So toll collection is for a specified period, right? Specified period, in exchange of toll collection, there is an asset that has been given to us on lease, which is basically the land, but the road, I should say. Now there is a specific guideline that has been given. That is why we are not covering it in this standard. We cover it over there. Licenses of intellectual property. Okay, intellectual properties granted by the lessor within IFRS 15. That means it is related to revenue. Maybe financial agreement is something we can say. Rights held by lessor under licensing arrangement within the scope of Ind AS 38, that is intangible assets such as motion picture film, video recording, plays, manuscript, patents, copyrights. So there is a specific standard that deals with the lease of the same, which is Ind AS 38. So we are not going to cover such intangible assets over here. But try to understand, these are the only intangible assets not covered over here. Other intangible assets which have been given on lease, okay, franchisee given on lease is covered over here. They have only excluded motion picture film, video recording, plays, manuscripts. These are what I excluded from here. Okay, I hope it is clear, it is understood. There are certain recognition exemptions given, like they are, if you don't cover it over here, it is fine. Exemption is given not to cover it over here. It is not that it is not covered over here and it is supposed to be covered over somewhere else. It is like, don't cover it over here. Don't account for them specifically and don't even account for them as per some other standards. Okay. One of them is short term lease, means lease for a period of less than 12 months. Other is lease for which underlying asset is of low value. The asset value is insignificant, immaterial. So asset with immaterial cost has been given on lease, we don't apply the standard. Asset for which the lease period is very short, less than 12 months, we don't apply lease. What is short-term lease? Leases on the commencement date, the date when the lease will start, have a lease period of 12 months or less, contains a purchase option. A lease that contains a purchase option is not a short-term lease. Like at the end of the lease, there is a purchase option, or anytime during the lease, there is a purchase option in which you can buy the asset. You can buy the asset. This is not short-term lease. These are leases that are covered in this chapter. Okay. So now, how do you define these 12 months? Now, there's a contract which says that you can take an asset on lease for 3 months. Short-term lease, 9 months. Short-term lease, 11 months. Short-term lease, 12 months. Short-term lease, 12 months, 1 day. This is not short-term lease. Okay. Now, in certain contracts, there is also a renewal option. 12 months and it can be renewed further. So, should I consider it as a short-term lease? Now, it depends. You need to ask the management or see the past experience. If the management says that, yes, we are going to renew the contract, This is not short term lease. If the management says no, we are not going to renew the contract, no past records of renewing the contract, this is short term lease. Okay. A owns real estate and leases of building to company B. A and B are under common ultimate control. No formal agreement is in place. And the lease simply rolls over from 1 month to the next. Either party is able to terminate the lease without notice. So it is just renewing after every month. And anyone can terminate as per the notice. Should it be considered to be a short-term lease? Maybe. Now it depends what will be the ultimate motive, what will be the end of the lease period. If anyone can terminate, this can always be considered to be a short-term lease, maybe. Okay. Maybe more than 12 months, and so the lease would not be able to take the advantage of short-term lease exemption. So it is just a maybe. We don't have a final answer available. So if we are not expecting the lease to be terminated for a specified period, since it is under common control, okay, common control, business combination, holding, subsidiary, anything like that, in such a case this is not short-term lease. But if we are expecting that it will end within next 12 months, then we consider it to be a short-term lease. Okay. Question: lessee enters into a lease of 9 month non-cancellable term, non-cancellable, okay, with an option to extend for 4 months. Option to extend for 4 months, that makes it 13 months. Lease does not have a purchase option. On the commencement date, the lessee is reasonably certain to exercise the extension option. Reasonably certain that you are going to extend the option is what the question is saying. Whether the lease can be considered a short-term lease, the answer is no. We have already discussed there is an expectation of renewal of the lease, hence it should not be considered to be short-term lease, and total now period is 13 months. Assume same facts, except at the commencement of lease, lessee is not reasonably certain to exercise the extension option. You are not sure whether extension will be exercised. Then can we claim the short-term exemption? Yes. Now we can claim the short-term exemption. I hope it is clear. Low value asset means values is insignificant. So it is checked on asset wise. Okay. Low value of lease asset is made on the basis of value of the asset when it was new, regardless of whether the actual asset being leased is new. Means when you have leased the asset, whether the asset is new or not, it does not matter. But when the date you have leased the asset, we consider the value. Assessment is made whether the lease asset is material to the lessee. Okay, now whether it is material to lessee or not, it doesn't matter. We always see from lesser's point of view. It doesn't matter for lessee, it could be a very big thing, but for lesser, it could be a very small thing. Like maybe you give 100 rupee of loan to any peon in the office. Okay, now for you, it may be a small amount, but for him, it could be a very big amount. Okay, so we don't consider what is the viewpoint of lessee. We always consider the viewpoint of lesser. Achieve the goal that different lessees should reach from same conclusion. Underlying asset can be of low value only if lessee can benefit from use of underlying asset in its own or together with other resources that are readily available to the lessee. Underlying asset is not highly dependent or highly interrelated with other assets. Okay, what it is saying is the underlying asset in a lease can be a low value lease or can be of low value lease only if you can benefit from underlying asset on its own. It can be used on its own or maybe with some other assets, and the underlying asset is not highly dependent or maybe highly interrelated with other assets which are also on lease. So they are interdependent assets, they are not dependent on anything else. A large multinational technology company, 10 billion in annual reporting, enters into a contract for one floor of office building in a major city of Central America at a lease of 50,000 per annum for 5 years. Okay. The operation of the facility and the lease cost are immaterial to entity A. Now, entity A, I believe over here is lessee. Okay. Floor of the office building is generally not considered to be a low value asset. So we should not consider as a low value just because A is a very large multinational company and it has entered into some contract. Okay. So that is why this should not be considered to be a low value asset. Generally, low value assets are considered to be telephones, laptops, or similar form of assets. Let's see certain more examples. A lessee in the pharmaceutical manufacturing and distribution industry has following lease. Lease of real estate. Obviously, this is not a low value asset. Manufacturing equipment. Generally, manufacturing equipment are not considered to be low value assets. Okay. Cars. Sale personnel, senior management, varying quality specifications. Okay, these are also generally not considered to be low value asset. They are cars, trucks, vans, same story. IT equipment by an individual employee, laptop, computer, desktops. Yes, they can be low value assets comparatively. Servers, including individual modules that increase storage capacity of the servers. Now, servers are generally something that are very costly. You should not consider them to be low value asset. Office equipment, maybe like water dispenser, something like that. Yes, you can consider it to be a low value asset. Office furniture, maybe water dispenser. Yes. High capacity photocopier, obviously no. Okay. So what is it saying? IT equipment to be used by individual office employee and water furniture. So we have considered 2, 3. We have also considered office equipment, but office equipment is something that they have not considered to be a low value asset. So we are not sure about what these office equipments are basically talking about. Okay. Inside G there were points 1, 2, 3. So out of 1, 2, 3, 2 are considered to be low value assets, others are not. Okay. Now when we talk about servers and all, it is a combined contract. Okay. It is a combined contract. We don't check them individually. So that is what is written. Each module within the server, if considered individually, might be low value. Leases of module within the server do not qualify as low value asset. Modules are interrelated. Okay. They are always working on interrelated basis. They cannot be used independent to each other. So that is why we consider the overall lease value to be a very significant amount. I hope the concepts that we have discussed till this point are clear. Let's talk about the first step, identifying a lease, whether a contract contains a lease or not. As we have seen the definition's first part talks about identified asset. There should be an underlying asset, identified asset. It should be for a specified period of time and it should be for a consideration. Okay. So before that, it also says there should be a contract or it can be a part of the contract. So it may be possible that a contract contains two aspects, lease component, non-lease component. This standard requires that you should split the lease and non-lease component based on some fair value of the asset, of what you are paying and of the consideration being paid for the contract. How much is for lease component and how much is for non-lease component? The bifurcation is required. Okay. Separation of lease component is very necessary. However, the standard also says it may be that non-lease component is of insignificant value. It may be possible that you have taken an asset on lease and along with asset there is a maintenance contract, like taking an office on rent, or maybe a house on rent, and you have to pay maintenance fees also along with it. It may be that the maintenance fees is very insignificant compared to the whole contract value. Then bifurcating is a very complex procedure. I mean, it requires time, and giving time to an insignificant immaterial item is illogical. So this standard tells you that don't bifurcate it. Okay. If the maintenance component is insignificant, consider the whole contract to be a lease contract. However, vice versa is also possible, that maintenance is a significant component and lease is a very minute component. Don't bifurcate it. Consider the contract to be a non-lease contract. Okay. So that is what it is saying. As a practical expedient, must allocate total contract consideration to lease and non-lease component. So which is a complex scenario. Consequence, using practical expedient, the amount recognized in balance sheet are greater than it would have been in case of payments separately accounting the non-lease component. Combining contracts. There may be two or more contracts which are lease contracts and which are similar in nature. So you may combine the contract. This standard also says that you must combine the contract if two contracts are considered to be interrelated to each other. Let's say there is a contract that I take up a factory on rent and another contract with the same person that your labor will work in that factory. So are they two different contracts or they are similar contracts? We should combine the contracts or we should treat them two different contracts? It says you should combine the contract if the contracts are negotiated as a package of overall commercial objective. Cannot be considered without considering the other. The one contract is dependent on another or vice versa. Amount of consideration in one contract depends on price or performance of the other contract. The prices are also considered to be interdependent. And right to use the underlying asset is conveyed in the contract from a single lease component. Now the example I gave you, taking a factory on rent and labor contract, they are dependent on each other, but we know one is lease contract and one is non-lease contract. So obviously we ourselves are not going to combine the contracts. But let's say you take a factory on rent and you also take machines on rent. Now machine cannot run without the factory, and a factory taking factory on rent without machines is also illogical, because ultimately you will have to buy the machines and keep it over there. So we can say that it may have been negotiated as a single package. Now maybe the price is defined in such a way, there is a variable consideration of as much production along accordingly the rent will be paid. As much of production accordingly the rent will be paid. So obviously rent of the factory and machine production are interrelated to each other. Maybe it is possible. Okay. So this says that in such a case you should combine the contract and treat it as a single contract. Now let's move to the very definitions part. Like first one was identifying a contract or part of the contract. Then comes asset. Asset should always be an identifiable asset. You should know which asset is taken on lease. Like if I have taken this calculator on lease, I should know that the rent that I am paying belongs to this calculator. It is related to this calculator. Okay. So how can that be possible when customer has control over the asset? Customer knows which asset he is going to use, when he is going to use, how he is going to use, for what time period he is going to use is known to him. Maybe you have some restriction on the asset. The lessor lays some restrictions on the asset. It may be possible that you cannot run the asset in a particular time, or you cannot take the asset somewhere outside. But till the time we are using it, we can use it as per our discretion is what matters, is what gives a control over the asset. Maybe let's say you take a house on rent. Okay. So when you take a house on rent, the lessor always tells you that you should not do a lot of party in the house, or there should not be a lot of sound because of which neighbors will have any problem. No such activity should be carried out and society guidelines should be followed. So there are restrictions, which doesn't mean that you are not taken something on lease. Obviously it is on lease and we have control over the asset. Okay. So same pattern it says, maybe you have sublet some work of yours to sub person on job work basis. But how much he has to produce, when he has to produce, how he has to produce is controlled by you. So it looks like it is job work, but actually it is not job work, it is lease. You have taken his factory on lease and you have asked him to give his service also during that period. Now how much to produce, when to produce, how to produce is decided by you, which means it is lease. But to do all such thing, the asset should be an identifiable asset. Now identifiable asset also means that lessor cannot substitute the asset. Now this is the first point that we are seeing. First is customer must have control over the asset. Okay. Then comes the next point where he says that lessor should not have the right to substitute the asset. Maybe he can substitute the asset, but substitution is practically not possible. Now let's say he has only one asset. He can replace it and give you another asset, but he has only one asset right now. So obviously, it cannot be substituted. It can be that if the service is being provided to the lessee related to an asset, the person can substitute and provide the same service related to asset from some other area, some other machine, some other asset, maybe. But practically it is, economically it is not viable for him to provide any such service. Then in such a case also, we can say that substitution is not possible. So always think, we look at substance over form. What can we see substantially rather than the legal terminology? We see if there is substitution is possible by lessor to replace the asset, the identified asset can be replaced very easily and which is of comfort to lessor as well. This is not a lease contract. Okay. Well, first point is control. Let's look at a question related to the same. XYZ enters into a 10-year contract with supplier ABC for the use of rolling stock specifically designed for customer XYZ. Rolling stock is designed to transport material in customer XYZ production process. So there is some rolling stock which is designed basically just for transportation of material to the lessee's process. Not suitable for other customers. So we know it is specific asset constructed for a specific lessee. Rolling stock is not explicitly specified in the contract, but ABC owns only one rolling stock. So it is not specified that there is a particular rolling stock which will only be used for this transportation purpose. But now our lessor has only one such rolling stock. Okay. That is suitable for XYZ. If the rolling stock does not operate properly, customer requires ABC to repair and replace the losing stock. So now there is always a point of exception that is given which says that if it is not working properly. So as long as it is working properly, it will not be replaced. If it is not working properly, then it will be replaced. So there's a condition. So it is still an identified asset. Don't say that, sir, if it does not work, we'll have to replace the asset. It is still a particular identified asset because it is conditional, not working properly. Then what will you do of that identified asset if it is not working properly? Okay, so it is conditional. Is it an identified asset? Yes, this is an identified asset because all conditions are satisfied. Practically, he may replace the asset, but substance over form, he will not because he has made this asset specifically for you. Did you get my point? Let's move ahead. Customer XYZ enters into 10-year contract with supplier ABC for use of a car. Specification of the car is specified. Which brand, which type, which color, everything. Car is not yet built. Now, obviously, customer XYZ from supplier ABC and the car is not yet built. Supplier ABC will make the car specifically for the customer. Let's say you say that I need a Maruti Swift red color to diesel type with dual tone option, the Asta model or any model you say, for to and fro for the next 10 years. Now the customer has not built it, he will build it. Can he replace it? Yes. Now everything is defined, but obviously it is not a specific asset. That will be defined, like he can replace it with another red color of Swift, same design, same option, everything same, just registration number will be different. But practically, is he going to replace it? No, unless the asset is not working properly. Did you get my point? So this is also considered to be a identified asset. So substitution, right? How do we know whether a supplier can substitute the asset when supplier has practical ability to substitute throughout the period of use? And practical ability means practically he should replace, and supplier would benefit from the exercise. Now he should not be at loss. Read supplier's benefit as he should not be at loss by replacing the asset. So if he is at loss by replacing the asset, lease is not beneficial for him. So obviously he is not going to replace it. This is a lease contract. If he replaces it, if he replaces it and it is economically beneficial, this is not a lease contract, this is a service contract to provide any asset. Like, he will decide which asset to be given. You can only use the asset. So replacement of asset is like a service, not considered to be an asset. Let's try to see an example related to the same. Contract between customer and supplier requires supplier to transport a quantity of goods by using specified type of rail car. Specified type of rail car. So you may have seen those rail bogies, red color rail bogies, carrying some form of goods, maximum times coal is carried in them. So now it is a specified type of rail car. Let's say it should have cold storage inside available or something like that. In accordance with stated timetable for a period of 5 years, timetable and quantity of goods specified are equivalent to a customer having use of 10 rail cars for 5 years. Supplier provides the rail car. He provides you with the driver. He provides you with the engine. Contract states the nature and quantity of goods to be transported. Type of rail car to be used. Supplier has large pool of similar rail cars. Large pool. So you need 10 rail cars. Let's say he has 100 such rail cars available. Similarly, supplier can choose to use any of the number of rail cars to fulfill each of customer's requests. So every time a customer's request is received, we don't send the same specified rail car. We can send any rail car because whichever is economically viable, whichever is easily available to be transferred, which will give us a benefit, we are going to transfer that one. Okay? To fulfill customer's request. And car could be used to transport not only customer's goods but also other customer's goods. So the same rail car can be used by other customers as well. So obviously we can see there is no identified asset, there is no control, and easy substitution right is available. So this is not considered to be a lease contract. Okay. Now suppose you have taken a portion of the asset on lease, but it is an identified asset and that portion is for an identified time period. And during that identified time period, substantially all benefits are available to you. Like particular time period, a particular asset will be used specifically by a person. Let's say I have a camera which I take on rent. During a time period, I am the only person that who will use that asset. Specified time period, I am the only person who will use that asset. So I'm not using the whole asset, but a portion of the asset for a portion of time. Yes, it can be considered to be a lease contract. But sometimes what happens is that let's say you have taken some machine on lease or some car on lease, and this can also be used for other purpose, but which is very immaterial. Like let's say I take up a car on lease. It is an identified car which should provide me service of to and fro Monday to Saturday. But I have taken the car for the whole year, Monday to Sunday. Now this person, this is an identified car, I decide where it should go, everything is defined, it is a lease. But this person every Sunday uses this car for as a taxi to take to and fro other people. So part of the asset is being used by others as well. But that portion is insignificant. If some order turns up, it may happen, otherwise it does not happen, which is very immaterial. So if substantially all benefits are taken by me, it is lease. But if it is not substantial, the other part is major, we don't consider it to be a lease. Let's try to help us understand this with an example. Customer enters into 15-year contract with a supplier for right to use a specified amount of capacity within a cable connecting Hong Kong to Tokyo. The specified amount is equivalent to customer having full capacity. The specified the quantity that you are using is equivalent to full capacity of three fiber strands. So let's say that this is some cable. Inside the cable you can always see there are lots of wires going on. So out of this, the capacity that we are going to use is equivalent to three fiber strands out of these cables. Supplier makes decision about transformation of data. The transfer of data decision is given by supplier. So let's say I am a customer, you are supplier, you have this cable wire available from Hong Kong to Tokyo. I want to transfer the data which is equivalent to three fiber strands. I don't decide which fiber strand will be used. You are going to decide which fiber strand is going to be used. So it may be that sometimes you use the first three fiber strands. You are the supplier, you have the control. The last line is saying that. Sometimes it may happen that you decide that I will use last three fiber strands. So you can use any fiber strand. So you are providing me with a service. You are not providing me with a specified identified asset. So I cannot say that this is a lease. This will not be considered to be lease. Okay. Substitution is possible. Customer enters into a 15-year contract with a supplier for right to use 3 of 10 specific strands from Paris to London. Customer has exclusive right. Customer, okay? Customer has exclusive right to use these strands. Now, customer decides which strand I am going to use for transfer. Now, customer has the control over these strands. So, now there are specific strands being used. Then it will be considered to be a lease contract. I hope it is clear. Another characteristic when I want to define whether it is an identified asset or not is that I should have some economic benefit from that asset. Like after the use of that asset, there should be some economic benefit. Customer controls the use of an asset. Identified asset is whether customer has right to obtain substantially all the economic benefit from the asset. But if a portion, the example I gave you of a car, is being used by someone else and it is immaterial, then it doesn't matter to us that much. Okay? Let's see. A retailer enters into a contract for lease of a store in a shopping center. So let's say you have a shopping center. I am a retailer. I have taken a store from your shopping center on lease for 5 years. Rental terms include payment equal to 10% of the gross sale revenue generated from store. So whatever is earned from store, 10% will be paid by me to you. Okay, it is your shopping center. I will pay 10% of my receipts to you. Retailer has the right to determine which products are to be sold. So if I am the retailer in the shop, which product is to be kept, when it is to be sold, how it is to be sold is decided by me. I am the controller. So obviously this is a lease contract, though it is not a specific rent contract. You have a profit share right, but you are not considered to be a partner over here. You are considered to be a lessor and I am considered to be a lessee because 90% cash flow comes to me and I am the one who is going to have economic benefit from the same. Okay. Let's move ahead. Customer enters into a contract where customer will purchase. We have a supplier who will give it to the customer 100% of the energy of biomass facility. So there is a supplier who has a biomass facility. He is providing electricity maybe or something, biomass energy that can be given by his factory or by his biomass facility. Now there is a customer who needs this biomass facility and he says that I will buy 100% of whatever energy that you are going to produce. Whatever energy that you are going to produce. Contract specified that energy must be produced from a particular facility, but the contract specifically says that it should be from a particular biomass facility, let's say a factory that is in Mumbai. A factory located in Mumbai, it should only be supplied from that factory. Okay, so there is an identified asset we can see. And so the supplier does not have substitution right. Substitution right is gone. Supplier receives tax incentives from various level of government for building the biomass facility as it produces clean renewable energy. So there is some government benefit, that is tax incentive, that is available. Now, is there an economic benefit to the customer from the same? Obviously, yes. But should we also consider this tax incentive for the picture? This question says that, see, why did you get the tax incentive? The first thing is, why did you get the tax incentive? Because you are providing renewable energy. You are not getting tax incentive because you have leased out this renewable energy. Whether you use yourself or you give it to someone on lease, it doesn't matter, or you sell it to 100 people. As long as you are producing biomass energy, you are getting tax incentive. So tax incentive is not related to lease contract. Tax incentive has nothing to do with lease contract. Are you getting my point? So we should not consider, while evaluating economic benefit, you should not consider this tax incentive. Why? It is not related to lease. When we are thinking about economic benefit, we think of economic benefit from lease. And we also consider all the restrictions that are placed on lease. So economic benefit, post restriction, how we can benefit from this lease. But we don't consider these tax incentive because it is not related to lease. Even if the lease was not there, this tax incentive would have been received. Okay. Right to direct the use of the asset is next characteristic of an identified asset. The customer must have the control and right on when to use, how to use, what to use, what to produce. Okay. Let's look at an example related to the same. Customer enters into a 5-year contract with the supplier where customer will purchase up to 100% of the energy of biomass facility. Same example that we have seen earlier. Energy must be produced from the particular facility and supplier does not have the substitution rights. Alternative arrangement. Alternative arrangement can only be made in extraordinary circumstances. Under the contract, customer tells the supplier how much energy to produce, when to produce, and supplier must be ready to operate the facility to meet the customer's needs. So we are not just buying 100% facility, but we also tell him when the production should take place. It's not that he can produce it anytime he wishes and we will buy it. No, we are telling him when he has to produce it. Okay. To the extent of spare capacity, to the extent there is spare capacity, supplier is not allowed to generate energy for sale to other customers. So it is substantial economic benefits are purely for the customer. You cannot sell it to anyone else. Supplier must therefore stand ready for all the power output to the customer if needed. Supplier designed the facility when it was constructed some years ago, before entering into the contract. So it is a predefined built as per customer needs. So it is a pure case of lease. Okay. So most of these examples looks like job work, but they are not job work. They are lease is what we need to understand now. Relevant decisions are predetermined. Same as the example we have seen earlier. If something is made specifically as per the decision taken, like to provide some service, some asset is being made, then it is clearly understood that this asset is on lease. Okay. So what it says is asset is relevant decisions are predetermined if customer has the right to operate the asset throughout the period of use. Customer designed the asset in a way that predetermines how and for what purpose it will be used. So it is designed as per customer's requirement. Let's look at an example. Customer enters into a contract with supplier where customer will purchase 100% of the energy. Customer designed the biomass facility before it was constructed by hiring experts in the field to assist in determining the location. Engineering. Supplier is responsible for building the facility. Now it is made as per customer design and requirement and location. Operating, maintaining is everything supplier's requirement. Okay, let's move ahead. Electronic data storage provider. Electronic data storage provider. So there is some cloud data provider like in ERP. Whatever data is to be stored will not be stored in your computer. It will be stored in some other storage provider's computer. Okay. Provide service through centralized data center, which involves use of specified server, server number 10. So it is a specified server. Supplier maintains many identical servers in a single accessible location. So in the same location, he has lots of servers that are available. At inception of the contract, that it is permitted and can easily substitute. Easily substitute. So substantial rights, substitution rights are there with the supplier without customer's consent. Further, the supplier would benefit economically from substituting an alternative asset. So if he substitutes it, there's a supplier has economic benefit because he can easily maintain and allocate the data as per his requirement. Okay, there's a new customer that turns up, he changes the server of the existing customer. Because doing that allows supplier to optimize the performance of the network at only a nominal cost. In addition, supplier is clear that he negotiated the right to substitution as an important right in the arrangement. So it is clear that it can be substituted. which says that you are providing a service and you are not providing an asset on lease. Okay. Scenario B, assume same facts except that server number 10 is customized and supplier does not have practical ability to substitute it. Now we know it is customized, made as per customer's requirement. It is not going to be replaced, substitute, like it is not economically viable or feasible. Then it will be considered to be a lease contract. Let's look at next question. Customer XYZ enters into a 15-year contract with supplier ABC for right to use five fibers within the fiber optic cable from Mumbai to Pune. Similar example. Contract identifies 5 of the 25 cable wires for use. 5 fibers are dedicated solely for customer XYZ data. Supplier does not have substantive substitution right. So yes, this is a lease contract because the wires cannot be changed. Scenario A, customer XYZ enters into 10-year contract with supplier ABC for right to transport oil from India to Bangladesh. Contract provides that customer XYZ will have the right to use 95% of the pipeline. Now they have 95% rights. 5% are still with the supplier. But 5% cannot be considered to be substantial. 95% is substantial, which means that pipeline is on lease. Now it is a specific pipeline. You cannot substitute the pipeline very easily. You cannot have thousands of pipelines from India to Bangladesh. So you have a specific pipeline that is being used and 95% capacity used by one customer, which means that the facility is on lease. Assume same facts except that XYZ has right to use 65% capacity. Now 65% cannot be substantial. Why? 35% is also substantial. 35% can be sold to other customers. You can decide when those 35% facility will be used by other customers. So when, how, what questions cannot be answered by customer. It can be answered by supplier. So that's where there's a difference. So though an identified asset, but this will not be considered to be a lease contract. Next question. ABC entered into a contract with XYZ which grants ABC exclusive right to use specific grain storage facility. Specific grain storage facility somewhere like a warehouse where grains will be stored for 5 years in the month of May to June. Now it is only for 2 months, May and June. 5 years but only 2 months. During these months, ABC has the right to decide which crop place in storage, when to remove them, provides loading unloading service to the warehouse. Other months, XYZ has the right to determine how the warehouse will be used. Now we are using for specific months, identified asset, same storage facility, specific month for consideration, and we are controlling what to keep, when to remove, decided by us. Now obviously the lease can be for a smaller period, like out of 1 year we are using only 2 months. This is a lease contract, we are controlling it and there are no substitution rights. You cannot say substantial rights are being used by others as well. We are using a portion of the asset. Okay, we are not using the whole asset, we are using a portion of the asset, but the time frame is defined, right? During that time frame, can anyone else use the asset? No. Did you get my point? This will be considered to be a lease. Next one. Company MNO enters into 15-year contract with power company PQR to purchase all electricity produced. PQR owns solar farm and will receive tax credits related to construction. So we have already seen that tax credit should not be considered because this is, you are using renewable energy is the reason you are getting credit and not because you are giving it on lease. MNO will receive renewable energy credit that accrue to solar farm. Are there substantial benefit? We don't consider the tax credits when we want to know the substantial benefit. Next one. Customer X enters into a contract with supplier Y to use vehicle for 5 year period. Vehicle is identified. Supplier Y cannot substitute unless it is not operational. So under the contract, X operates the vehicle, directs others to operate, so either he is using it or the driver is using it, decides how to use the vehicle, prohibits certain use of vehicle. That certain restrictions are there given by the supplier, but ultimately customer can use it as per his requirement. This is a lease contract. Okay, next one. Entity A contracts with supplier H, a manufacturer of parts. Entity A designed the facility and provided its specification. H owns the facility and the land. A specifies how many parts it needs. 1. When it needs. 2. H operates the machine and makes all operating decisions how and when the parts are to be produced as long as it meets the contractual requirement. So now it is predetermined. Factory was made specifically for the customer. Assuming H cannot substitute the facility, it is an identified asset. Do you control the asset? Okay. Supplier H operates the machine and makes all operating decisions on how and when the parts are to be produced. Now see, how they are to be produced and when they are to be produced is decided by supplier. How many parts are to be produced and when the parts will be needed is decided by customer. But how and when to operate is not decided by the customer. Okay, he says we'll need the parts on a specified date. You can produce it before that date anytime as you wish, either today or maybe next month or maybe the following month. So this cannot be considered to be a lease contract. Okay, this will not be considered to be lease. A does not direct the use of the asset, so therefore the arrangement is not a lease contract. I hope it is clear. We look at next question. L enters into 5-year contract with A, a ship owner. Use of identified ship. L decides whether and what cargo will be transported and when and to which ports the ship will sail. L. Okay. So L is the customer. He is deciding on most of the things. Subject to restrictions. Restrictions prevent L from sailing the ship into waters at high risk piracy. So, just a bit of restriction for control purpose, no loss to the supplier. Otherwise, customer directs everything. So, this will be considered to be a lease contract. Okay. A lessee enters into a lease of an excavator and related accessories that are used for mining purpose. Lessee is a local mining company that intends to use the excavator at a copper mine. How many lease and non-lease components are there? So the lease is of excavator and related accessories. Accessories are generally considered to be immaterial. So this will be considered local mining company and use it for copper mine. So a complete thing will be considered to be a one lease contract. Assuming fact same except that contract also conveys the right to use additional loading truck. Now truck is not dependent on excavator. It can be used without excavator also. So it should be considered to be a separate, like there should be two lease contracts now. Okay. Two lease contracts. Let's look at the next question. L rents the office building from landlord M for 10 years. L is the customer, M is the supplier. Rental contract stipulates the office is fully furnished and has newly installed tailored HVAC system. It also requires landlord to perform all common area maintenance. So it could be insignificant, maintenance could be insignificant. We had discussed this. During the term of agreement, L makes single monthly rental payment, does not pay for maintenance separately. Office building has a life of 40 years and HVAC and office furniture has a life of 15 years. So now you have taken the office for a lease of 10 years. Okay. Now generally maintenance is considered to be immaterial. So the whole office should be considered to be a lease contract. Now, whether it is one lease or multiple lease, furniture can be considered to be a separate asset. Office building can be considered to be a separate asset. So, they can be considered to be different leases over here. Let's look at next question. Lessee enters into 5-year lease of equipment with annual payment of 10,000. Contains fixed annual payment, 8,000 rent, 1,500 maintenance, 500 admin task. How the consideration would be allocated? Now basically it has two components, lease and non-lease component, but we can see non-lease component, yes, it is kind of material, okay. So, but since the asset cannot work, now it depends. Maintenance can be considered to be a separate contract or it could be considered to be a part of the contract. Allocated to lease and non-lease component. B, contain two component, lease component and non-lease component. The amount paid for admin task does not transfer a goods or service to the lessee. Okay. Now it says there is an admin task amount that is paid. Okay. Assume same facts as A. In addition, the contract requires the lessee to pay for restoration of the equipment to its original condition. How should it be allocated? Now it should be considered to be a part of lease because you have to restore the asset to its original condition. Okay. The story remains kind of same, but the restoration is considered to be a part of asset. Okay. Let's move ahead. A lessee enters into a lease of an equipment. The contract stipulates the lessor will perform maintenance of the leased equipment and receive consideration for the maintenance. Contract includes following fixed prices. Lease 80, maintenance 10. Now maintenance is material comparatively. Assume the standalone price cannot be readily observed. So the lessee makes estimate, maximizing the use of information. Lease and non-lease component. Lease has a fair value of 85 and maintenance has a fair value of 15. Now you should not consider what is written in the contract, substance over form concept. Since the fair value is different, what you have read in Ind AS 115 revenue recognition, that concept should be applied and accordingly the lease should be allocated in the same pattern. So 90,000 overall rent, we know 85% is generally considered to be lease component. So you consider 76,500 to be lease component and 90,000 into 15% to be non-lease component, the maintenance component. Okay, non-lease component will be accounted as per Ind AS 115 revenue recognition. And 76 as lease component. From lessee's point of view, 13,500 will be considered to be an expense, deferred expense, and to be treated accordingly. So I hope the concepts that we discussed till this point is clear and understood by you.